right, guys. Well, while that loads, I'm super excited for today's call. Eric is super near and dear to my heart. Not only is he in the Northeast region, but I've watched him come in and just literally explode this thing. Go from Hall of Fame producer to now integrity partner. So if you thought for 1 second that you were on the wrong call, you are on the absolute right one. There's not many people in this business that you can learn more from than Eric Schmidt. All right, Eric, we still can't see you, but I have faith. All right, there you go. How are you doing today, Eric?
Doing good, thank you.
Awesome. I'm super excited to be on with you today. And Eric, if you could just backtrack a little bit, like what were you doing prior to Family First Life? What made you decide to join Family First Life? What does that kind of look like for you? Or what did that look like for you?
So from 1995 to 2018, I was in the car business. So 23 years, I was in the car business. Graduated from University of Connecticut in 94, started in the car business in 95. And did get my life insurance license for the first time. Sean Mike recruited me in 2008, got my license then, only had it for a short amount of time. Depending on how much time we have, I can get into that story and why we stopped. But the housing crash really squashed that in 2008. And then in 2018, when I was seeing how much people were claiming that they were making in this opportunity, I reached out to Eric Anthony, reached out to Sean Mike, and said, hey, you know, if these numbers are real, then I'm going to get out of the car business, because even though I was making like 275 grand a year in the car business, it was taking 70, 80 hours a week of my life, which there was still plenty of time left. We'll probably get into that later. But those retail hours, when you have a 17-year-old, a 14-year-old, an 11-year-old, you've been married 25 years, it just became really challenging, you know, on us. So this was a much better fit. And then ultimately, the 275 a year W-2 was okay. You know, what the opportunities are here financially are way beyond that. So
I love that. And Eric, so when you initially started with Family First Life, you transitioned, right? You weren't full-time from the jump.
Well, you know, I like to tell everyone, Christina, I did full-time. I don't really believe in part-time. So I was full-time at the dealership, and then if I wasn't scheduled to be at the dealership, then I was doing this. So, for example, so for people that may be like kind of trying to figure out this thing and try to transition it, or if my shift started at 9 or let's say 8:30 a.m. at the dealership, I would get to the dealership at 7, not go inside the dealership, stay in my car, and around 7:25, I would start dialing, and I would dial for an hour before my shift at the dealership started. I would dial my lunch break, you know, I would just get in my car, go find an abandoned parking lot somewhere. And then as soon as my shift was over at the dealership, I was out, and I was trying to squeeze in an appointment every night after that, whether it was 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 o'clock, whatever time I got out, I was trying to squeeze a life insurance appointment in after that. If it was my day off, then I did life insurance all day. And my main goal, Christina, I was netting about $20,000-$25,000 a month in the car business. That was my deposits. Plus I had health insurance. Plus I had two demos that I didn't have to pay for. So I knew what I had to replace. And I told myself, if I could replace what my net income was in the dealership, plus, you know, the cars and the health insurance, then once I went only full-time life insurance, I knew I could do it. So by mid-March of 2019, I passed my exam in December of 18. And I went to convention. You guys were talking about convention earlier. I went to convention February 19. It was on January 31st that year, which was the last day of the month. So in the car business, that's like a mortal sin. Like, you never miss the last day in the car business. But I drove up to Boston, got on the first flight, and flew out, threw my bags in the corner when I got to the casino, and I went inside the place there. It was packed, a smaller venue than than where we're going to be this fall, this February. But and then by mid-March of 19, I knew that I could replace my income. And I started this April 1st, full-time of 2019, but there was no safety net. There was no golden parachute. There was no backup plan. This was going to be it. So, there's no other income in our household. So it was all on me.
I love that. And just to kind of backtrack a little bit, Eric, I know you said you were working 70 to 80 hours a week at the car dealership. How long did it take you to actually get licensed?
In Connecticut, it's required to you do 40 hours. Every state's different. Some states there's no requirement. Some states it's 20 or 10. Mm-hmm. In Connecticut, it's required that you do 40. So I did about six, seven, 8 hours a day for 5, 6 days. You know, I got up 2, 3 hours before everybody woke up in my house. I went to bed 2 to 3 hours after everybody went to bed in my house. And I just jammed it in because I knew I didn't have to get 100. I just needed to pass. So I got a 77 and that was good enough to get my life license. And then recently I just went back and got my health license because for me, now everyone's different, but I just needed to replace that income. I needed to get out of car business. So I needed to go fast in Connecticut. That was as fast as I could do it. And there was no options then. In some states, there are options to take them at home, but there was no take it at home option then. So I went to a testing center and got my 77 and that was it.
Okay. So it took you like a week to get licensed to actually take the exam. Okay.
Yeah.
So no longer than that. So working 70, 80 hours and you still completed the course and passed the exam within about a week or so.
Yeah. And again, it was now for some people, it's not that important. For some people, they think they have to know everything. They do flashcards and write everything out on index cards. Like I watched the videos ad nauseum, like nonstop. Videos, quizzes, practice exam. I mean, I didn't write down every little thing. You know, I wanted to get all the main general concepts, but I knew I didn't have to memorize everything. So, you know, I think if it takes you, I mean, let's just, you know, things come up in life, right? But I think if it takes you more than 10 days to get your license and exam passed, you're probably doing something wrong, with all due respect, of course.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. And one of the things I love about you, Eric, is just you're so intentional. Like in every single thing you do, you're very intentional. Now, when you made that transition, ultimately, I know you said you were basically full-time. It took you, I'm bad with math. So was that 3 months to actually make that transition out of the car dealership to Family First Life?
Yeah, so I got my Amerigo writing number probably December 10th to 15th, somewhere in that bucket. And then I was buying all second chance leads. So I was waking up like 3, 4, 5 o'clock in the morning. I would get all the leads, all the brand new leads. I would buy them at the $8, $7, $8, $9 price. Everything in Connecticut, Massachusetts, and Rhode Island I could find. I would buy all those second chance leads, 1 month old, 2 month, 3 month old leads. Cause I really didn't have a ton of money, you know, to burn on this thing. And I remember one of the first Facebook campaigns I got when the leads were $25 each, which they still are with some campaigns. Some campaigns, they're a little bit more than that. And the first one I called and the person's like, that's not my number. Don't ever call me again. I'm like, oh my God, I just burned $25. Like I was sick to my stomach. But I got up super early and got those leads. And did I answer the question yet? I think I got off on a little bit of a tangent there.
No, you're totally fine. You're totally fine. So essentially I said, how long did it make you, take you to actually make that transition?
The 6 weeks, like mid-December to the end of January. Then I went to convention. And then when I was at convention, I talked to some lead vendors. And when my plane landed in Boston, I turned my lead campaign on because I paused it when I left Las Vegas and I unpaused it when I landed in Boston and I started getting leads right away. Those are just like the instant internet leads that we get today. It's through a different company that's still out there. I made the investment in leads. You know, I didn't like the money that I was earning from policies that I was selling while I was doing both. I didn't need that money to run my household. I needed that money just as proof that I could make it. And then I just, you know, spend everything back in on leads again. I wasn't like, you know, and at that time I wasn't hiring staff or getting office space or anything like that. I was just like, hey, you know, can I do this? Right. So, I put everything back in leads and that gave me the opportunity to not get emotional if someone hung up on me or, not get too excited if they told me to go fly a kite or something like that. So.
What is your biggest month, Eric?
87.
Okay. All right.
That was a fluke. I mean, I was in 19, I never did less than 40. And in 2020, I never did less than 50. That 87 month, you know, again, I didn't do anything special, you know, just everything kind of lined up that month. But, you know, I started going with, I don't know who taught it to me, but, you know, every appointment that I went on, Christina, I had 5 door knocks stapled to that lead. So, you know, if for any reason I couldn't get in the house or you know, there was a one leg situation or family emergency or whatever, like emotionally that didn't really affect me because I already knew I had 5 leads that I had to go resolve within a 20-mile radius. And I already had that stuff loaded into my road war. So literally, like if I got to the house and they didn't answer and I knocked, like it was the cops coming in. But if they didn't answer, then boom, like I was like, all right, you know, I got an hour to my next appointment. I got 5 door knocks. So and if I did land on one of those door knocks, then I would just go late to the next one. And eventually I would catch up. But I really took that attitude and activity. And your attitude, it's hard for your attitude ever to go down when you're so busy with activity. And that was super important to me.
I love that. And I think that you've really implemented that into your team as well. What is your team's biggest month, Eric?
Just under 1.3 million.
Awesome. Awesome.
And we got a long way to go. We got a long way to go.
And Eric, when did you decide that you wanted to actually build a business with Family First Life? And how did you juggle producing at such a high level and also building a business? What did that kind of look like for you on the day to day?
So when I was in Las Vegas at that first convention, and I think it's just another reason why convention's so important. And it was a little bit more of an intimate setting there, but you know, they did kind of like a Q&A, which you can never do now at our convention. But you know, like people like Frank Ufemia and Dominique Rogers, they're like, well, what would you have done differently if you could go back to day one and redo it? And the consistent message was they would have started, you know, hiring, recruiting in the beginning, not to be a secret agent. And it doesn't matter if you're great at this or if you suck at it. If you suck at it, it's very selfish of you not to share with other people that might need to make some additional income outside of what they're currently doing. So that was one of the things I came home with in February of 19. And I started sharing with everyone. Obviously, I was still a little bit undercover, down low stuff, because I was still full time at the dealership. But I did start sharing it right away. I couldn't blast it on social media or nothing like that. But I did start sharing it with people right away. And some of those people I shared with are still, you know, working with me today and doing this at a high level. But as far as doing both, I remember Mike Killamet saying, hey, when you get back in your car from your appointment, there's never a better time to call a resume. And, you know, that's, you know, not that this was like a gazillion years ago, but you would print them out and you would have them like your sister is the queen of printing stuff out. But like I would have them on my passenger seat. And so after I got done with the appointment, I would get that resume right and I would call it up. And there's never a better time to do that, because if you just help the family, right, and you know, it was a $50, $100, $200 a month policy, you're calling that candidate, you know, on the resume, you know, excited about the family you just helped. But at the same time, if you were unable to help that family, right, for whatever reason, they didn't trust you, you made it too expensive, whatever the situation is, there's never a better time to resell yourself on the opportunity by calling a resume. So I guess we can bring it up now, but the 168 hours a week that we all get, you know, we do a really poor job at managing that amount of time. So when you start thinking about that much time, Christina, right? So say you sleep for 40 hours a week, right? Which is whatever, you know, it's like whatever, 6 hours a night, right? 6-7 hours a night. And say you work out for 20 hours a week, which is probably more than most people do, okay? But let's say you work out, and that includes drive time, shower, getting dressed, all that stuff. That's 60 hours. Let's say you hang out with your boyfriend for another 20 hours. That's 80 hours, okay? You still have, you know, whatever the math is, you still have another 70 hours left in a week, right? And you haven't even worked yet, you know? So, I mean, there's tons of time, right? And I think we all do a really poor job managing that time. And I think, you know, the one common trait that you see amongst the 26 some odd integrity partners, the board members that are out there, is they really take advantage of their time. You know, they're up four o'clock in the morning. They're at the gym by 5. You know, they're done by 7. And, you know, depending on, you know, where you are, you know, East Coast, West Coast, you know, they've already taken advantage of all that time, and they've already been on the CRM. They've already bought all the leads. So when you get up at 8:30 and you roll over and you're like, oh, there's no leads, that's because the people got up at 3:30 and bought them. You know, there's plenty of leads, right? So I think, you know, balancing and building, I think it's, you know, you wake up super early and you pass out at night, and then you wake back up and you check your, you know, and again, it's kind of just something that has to be in you. And if you make it all about the clients that you're helping, because now that I've been, this is going on my fourth year or whatever the math is, you know, there's people die, right? So, I mean, another death claim. It's just like, and you remember that family, and you know that the beneficiary, there was no way that they were going to be able to afford the expenses that were going to be incurred by that person dying. And so it's when it's all about the people and helping the people, it really makes it special.
100%. And I always like to say, like, I think when you get your first death claim, that makes it real.
You know, well, when you get your first paycheck, it makes it real. But when you get your first death claim, then it makes it real about the people, for sure.
Right. And Eric, how important was like plugging into an office for you?
Yeah. So there was no office here. I think Matt Walker was in the Gales Ferry office, and I think that's where Marisa went.
Okay. I didn't realize you were in Gales Ferry, Eric. Okay. Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So Christina would pull in with her leased Cadillac with way too many, I mean, Marissa did, with way too many miles on it. And she'd have double, you know, all those binders and everything clutched to her chest, not trying to drop everything walking in. But I didn't, you know, I did all the dialing from my house in the beginning. And then I started going down to the Gales Ferry office. But, you know, I think, you know, and this, we didn't do a lot of Zooms. There was really no Zooms. You know, this was in 19, you know, in 20. But I did get on a lot of calls, right? So I got on the weekly Southeast call with Mike Killamet and John Wetmore. You know, I was always on that call with Dom. So it is a lonely business, and it's important to stay plugged in, and it's important to find those people that you connect with. And it doesn't make a difference. Like Afro is here in our office in Ellington, Connecticut. She's here every week. It's just important to find, you know, those people that you clicked and you meld and you link up with. It doesn't make a difference who they work with. And, you know, we have support all around the country. I was talking to a client the other day, and not a client, a potential agent in Wisconsin. And they're like, oh, well, you don't, no. Toledo, Ohio, they live. And they're like, oh, you know, I don't know. There's no local support. I said, are you near a computer? So I just had him go to familyfirstlife.com. I had him click on Ohio. There's four offices. There's one in Toledo, one in Columbus. It's like equidistant from where he is in Akron. I'm like, there you go. I mean, you don't have to go too far to find help here. So
100%. Yeah. I think WorkSpots has been such a game changer, just allowing agents to plug into various offices and whatnot across the country. Mm-hmm. Eric, when did you bring on your first staff member, and what did that kind of look like for you? Like what were, when you initially hired your first staff member, what were their roles and goals, if you will? Like what were the expectations for them?
Well, they had to be, you know, they were the everything, right? Because I had this written down somewhere. I don't know if I can find it. They were the everything for sure. Okay, Christina. They had to, anybody that had joined the agency, all the calls went to them. She handled all the calls. I said, you're going to do everything that I don't want to do and everything I don't have time to do, because we need to grow the agency. And I can't, you know, I always wanted to be in a position of yes, and I've talked about this before, but I always wanted to be in a position of yes for any opportunity that ever came across the agency way, whether that was staff, office, marketing, leads, travel, anything. And that required me never to sell less than $50,000 a month. So I said, you know, you're responsible for everything. If I have a question with the carrier, you're going to call them. If I have a question on this, you're going to call them. This isn't a 8-to-4 job or a 9-to-5 job. This is, if the agency doesn't grow type of job, then you no longer have a job here type of job. Mm-hmm. But the good news is I think she started at $18 an hour. I paid her a salary, but you know, that's the way we did. It was based on 40 hours. But then when the agency went and I think I hired her 6 months in, maybe 9 months in, Christina. And whenever the agency hit certain levels, she got a pay increase. And then on some levels, she got a pay increase and a cash bonus.
Okay.
So she was completely tied into the performance of the agency. And if the agency didn't grow, you know, I can't fire myself. So the only person to fire is her. Now that person's no longer with us, which I think is another important step. You know, when do you hire? When do you fire? Right. You know, if you're not growing, then it's not the right person. I mean, they're in charge of growing that base shop. Okay. Outside of what you're doing. So yeah, that's important as well.
What does your staff look like now? Like when you hit integrity, what did your staff look like, Eric?
We had four and now we're down to two. Okay. You know, I'm doing all the recruiting. So any lead that comes in, licensed, unlicensed, cold market, warm market, social media, I'm the one that's making the initial call, the second call, the third call. I'm doing all the follow-up. When they're ready to go live, we plug them into the system and then they kind of go into our funnel and then they can kind of go from there. But okay, if there's a 10-day, you know, Excel solutions and there's no movement, I'm the one that's calling. You know, there, we have some automation set up. We use monday.com as our tool for that, which is a great tool, a lot of customization, but you know, it takes a lot to kind of build it out. But when you have it dialed in, it works well. So we have, Nadia that pretty much runs the office, right? She does contracting, you know, she does everything, right? And then because I'm not good at social media and I'm twice the age of most of the people that I want to work with, we have a social media gentleman. His name is Asaya Allgood, and he does all the social media for us.
Awesome. Awesome. I love that. Well, thank you so much for being on with me today, Eric. I appreciate you taking time out of your day. Before we hop off, any parting thoughts, any advice for new agents, anything else you want to add?
You know, I'll definitely repeat convention. I think it's so important. There's no legitimate reason why you can, that you'll be able to sell me on why you're not going to go. Now, 100%. There's obviously exceptions. Okay. So, I mean, if you have a very ill loved one, but you know, if money is the challenge, we'll find a way to get you there, whether that's rooming up with people, there's a, I'll tell the state of Florida back. Whether it's rooming up with someone, okay, you know, connecting with someone that's got a big Airbnb down there. You know, there's a lot of like, you know, JetBlue and American and, you know, different airlines where you can do 12 equal payments. So if the flight is $500, you can do $60 a month for 12 months, you know, at 0%, you know, so, you know, or ask your manager, hey, if I do 20,000 in February, can you reimburse me for my flight? Or 20,000 in January, can you reimburse me for my flight? You know, there's a lot of creative ways, but it's just so important to get there. You can, you know, and it's free. I mean, if you ever wanted to see these speakers, if you ever wanted to see Alex Rodriguez speak, you'd have to spend $1,000. Right. If you wanted to go to a Damon John, you know, speaking engagement, it would cost you hundreds and hundreds of dollars, you know. So, and I think when you get there, you know, write down 5, 10, 15 people like, hey, when I'm there, I'm going to meet Rob Richmond and I'm going to introduce myself and I'm going to ask him these two questions, you know, and I'm going to meet Paul McClain or Wiley Hawkins or Zach Twardowski, or I'm going to meet these people and these are the, I'm going to take a picture with them so I can use it in my social media, right? Get content when you're down there. And then I'm going to ask these questions. Because why should I have to try to figure it out? They've already figured it out, right? So I think that, and you know, this business will kick your butt, you know, so find a friend, right? Don't let yourself get too emotionally high when you have a really good day or really good week. Don't you let yourself get too emotionally low when you wake up to a chargeback or a roll-up debt or a roll-up lead. You know, just like I never had a problem with chargebacks, Christina, because I was always working. always working, always working, always working, always working. Schedule yourself out. And when you have, these calendars, right? And I use a Google calendar and all that stuff, but I use, one of these, these calendars as well, right? Schedule yourself out. How are you going to do 130 appointments this month? How are you going to do 130 appointments in January? Do you know what your schedule looks like in February? If your goal is to do 130 appointments in February, do you know what that looks like today on December 15th? Because you're going to be traveling here and doing this. Are you going to try to work in some hybrid sales? Are you going to make it an excuse? Or are you going to make it an opportunity that you're in Miami and you can work West Coast leads, right? And you can take advantage of the time zone and stuff right. like that. So, and it's not forever, guys. Like my goal, like when I got my license, my goal was to sell life insurance for 2 years. By the age of 50, and I'm almost 51, I'll be 51 in 3.5 months. But by the age of 50, I didn't want to have to sell life insurance anymore. Okay. I still do, but I didn't want to have to do it. Right. So set goals out there, like you were talking about before, goal setting with Paul McLean, I think is fabulous. I think it's a great idea. I love Paul. I could listen to him read the phone book. But you guys have an amazing leader, right, with Paul and the whole West Coast team. But take advantage of it. And like I said, don't feel like you can't ask somebody for help to try to get to convention, right? It's a huge mistake that you'll make. And then, come March and April when other people are growing, and you're like, I just don't get it. The leads suck and Paul sucks and Christina sucks and, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, maybe you suck, So I'm sure there's a way that you can figure it out and win like so many other people are.
100%. Thank you so much for being on with me today, Eric. You're welcome. I appreciate You're welcome. You so much. I hope you have an awesome holiday.
I will. Thank you. You too.
All right. Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.